Good morning. It is 2014. Happy New Year to you, and we are in the house of the Lord today. That makes it worthwhile. Let's do our best to glorify Him today, and no matter how you do it, just let Him have it, and we'll start this year off that way, and hopefully it'll continue in throughout the whole year. I pray to God today this will be the last service we have in 2014. You know where I'm headed? Huh? Because the next one will be with Him. What a great day of just being with Him. What a great day of just being eternal with Jesus Christ and our God. The thought of that just spellbounds me. But it's great to have everybody with us this morning.
Good morning. Good morning. Sorry, we're moving kind of slow this morning. Good to see you in the house of the Lord. Happy New Year to you. And we love you. It's so good to see you. And I got a question I want to ask you. And I want you to ponder that question for me until we get to preaching time. And here's the question that I want to ask you. What was your attitude this morning when you came into the house of the Lord? I want you to ask yourself that question. What was my attitude? Don't ask it for your wife. Don't ask it for your husband. Don't ask it for your children as an individual. I want you to ponder that question in your heart. What was my attitude when I came into the house of the Lord this morning? Thank you very much.
Good morning again. We're doing things different. God works in mysterious ways.
love, this cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when striving cease, my comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe, this gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save, till on that cross as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied, for every sin on him was laid, here in the death of Christ.
Asked you a question there in the beginning about your attitude. What was your attitude when you came into the house of the Lord this morning? I don't know if you give much thought to it, but our attitude is really like the steering wheel of your car. It steers and directs us throughout the course of the day in the direction that we'll go. It can be a good attitude or it can be a bad attitude. And there's enough bad attitude to go around for the whole world, I can assure you. But I believe the child of God should have a good attitude. I believe he should have a right attitude. I believe he should display that. I believe a part of the light that Jesus asked for you and I to allow to shine in our lives and in our hearts and in our day-to-day activity includes our attitude. And that's what I want to speak to you about this morning is our attitude in light of how it affects our worship and how it affects our work and our calling that the Lord Jesus Christ has called us to. What was your attitude when you came into the house of the Lord this morning, into His house, into this house of prayer, into His church, the church of the living Christ, the church that He died and gave His life for? When you got up this morning and you walked on His earth, and you got into the blessings that He's given you from the moment you got out of the shower and began to put clothes on your back, to putting the shoes on your feet, to going out the door and locking the door of your home and taking the keys, unlocking the door to your car, getting in your car, was full of gas, and driving to the church, and this is your church, and being able to come into a warm, nice, cozy, beautiful house of worship, sit down with a good old-fashioned King James Holy Bible in your hand, be able to open up the pages of that Bible, and with your eyes you were able to see the words. This morning I was able to listen to my Sunday school teacher, Brother Roy Edgar, bring a beautiful lesson on the Sabbath and what the Scripture teaches about the Sabbath. And I was able to listen to you sing this morning, "Holy, holy, holy art thou, Lord God Almighty." And I was able to walk on this stage and proclaim the glorious gospel of Jesus Christ. And I'm able to look out at you now as you look back at me. And I know that we are the redeemed of the Lord, that our sins have been blotted out, our sins have been forgiven. God has given us everlasting and eternal life, and there's nothing we can do to change the way He loves us. There's nothing that you can do to make Him love you any less. And there's nothing you can do to make Him love you any more. It is set in the gospel message of how He loves us so much that He'd be willing to die than to live without us. My friend, that should cause us to rejoice. That should cause us to get under the spout where the glory runs out and just sit there a little while and shout her out, say amen. Thank you, God, for loving me. Thank you for caring about me. Thank you that you died on the cross. You rose again the third day. And because you came out of that grave, we are assured of life and victory and power through Jesus Christ and all that He's done. Are you happy to be saved this morning? Are you happy you'll never have to spend 1 second in hell? Are you happy that you'll never have to experience the wrath and judgment of Almighty God on your rebellion and your sin? Aren't you glad this morning? Say, thank you, Jesus. I'm glad to be saved. Amen? Hayden Planetarium in New York put an ad in a New York newspaper to those who would like to make the first journey to another planet. Within just a few days, over 18,000 people applied to take a journey to another planet. Those 18,000 plus applications were given to a psychologist. He reviewed those and afterwards concluded that the vast majority of those who wanted to start a new life on another planet was because they were so discouraged with this one. What is your attitude toward life? When you wake up in the morning and you look across the horizon of the day, what does your attitude suggest? What does it say? It's so very, very important. I want you to listen to some words of Chuck Swindoll regarding attitude. He says, words can never adequately convey the incredible impact of our attitude toward life. The longer I live, the more convinced I become that life is 10% what happens to us and 90% how we respond to it. I believe the single most significant decision I can make on a day-to-day basis is my choice of attitude. It is more important than my past, my education, my bankroll, my success or failures, fame or pain, what other people think of me or say about me, my circumstances or my position. Attitude keeps me going or cripples my progress. It alone fuels my fire or salts my hope. When my attitude is right, there's no barrier too high, no valley too deep, no dream too extreme, no challenge too great for me. Attitude. Our attitude affects our life. It'll either give you success or it will cripple you. That's how important our attitude is, this thing called life really is. What is your attitude toward your wife, your children, toward life, toward your career, toward perhaps your education? I will need your undivided attention for the next few minutes. These words God has placed on my heart for a purpose. These words God has placed on my heart over the last 2 weeks as we have hit the ground in 2014, and I pray we hit it running with the right attitude for the next 12 months. It will either cripple us or it will progress us. And it's up to you and I as to which it will be. I asked you, what is your attitude toward life? Let me ask you this, what is your attitude toward church? What is your attitude toward worship? What is your attitude toward God and the gospel of Jesus Christ? Because there needs to be a certain attitude when we come into the house of the Lord. It needs to be a worshipful attitude. It needs to be a thankful attitude. It needs to be a humble attitude as we come into the presence of God Almighty, and as we face the truth of the gospel of Jesus Christ and what He has done for you and I, that we have obtained such a great salvation. Attitude. Our attitude about church. Let's just, how's the saying go? Let's just go to where the rubber meets the road. Everything hinges on what I'm about to tell you about our attitude toward worship. Now, I don't need to tell you there's not always a good attitude in church or about church. You can go to church and find some of the ugliest attitudes you'll ever find and experience in all of life, right in the church of Almighty God. That should not be. That's not biblical. That's not scriptural. It's not godly to come into church with a trifling, sorry, pathetic attitude about brothers and sisters in Christ, or somebody's upset, or this, that, or the other. That's not what we come here for. And we got to come with the right attitude if we're going to be able to have the right worship and bring honor and glory to Jesus Christ. You need to know this. I need to know this. We need to understand this so that when we come in here, we've got the right attitude of worship. Because I can tell you one thing. When we leave here in a little while, in the eyes of God Almighty, our worship is either worthy worship or it's worthless worship. And it's all determined by our attitude. Did I spell that right? Glory to God. I learned something. It's determined by our attitude. So this is what the scriptures say. And Brother Roy brought this out this morning in his Sunday school class. The Pharisees had heard that he had put the Sadducees to silence. They were gathered together. And then one of them, which was a lawyer, asked him a question, talking about the Lord Jesus Christ, tempting him and saying, "Master, which is the greatest commandment in the law?" Which is the greatest one? Jesus answered him, "Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart and with all thy soul and with all thy mind." That's a lot of love. To love Him with all of your heart, to love Him with all of your soul and with all of your mind. Now that's reasonable because He's a lovable God. He's a wonderful God. He's a great God. He's a good God. And then it's like He steps off of the planet, y'all. You like that, didn't you? Y'all. It's like He steps off and He says, "This is the first and great commandment." And then this is what He says. "And the second is like unto it." It's His twin brother. "Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself." And then He says this, on these two commandments hang all the law and all the prophets. Everything we do in Christendom hinges on those two things. This is what my Sunday school teacher said this morning. You get those two right, everything else will line up. And so what that means is when we love the Lord with all of our heart, soul, and mind, that means we come with an attitude of worship. We come with an attitude of humility. We come with an attitude of bowing in the presence of a holy, holy, holy God. And worship and adoration for who He is and what He's done for you and I and is doing and will do as our Heavenly Father. What is our attitude toward this Creator? What is our attitude toward this Sustainer when we come into the house of the Lord? You see, He says everything hangs on this fact. You love the Lord. You've got an attitude of worship toward Him. You've got a relationship with Him. You love Him. You desire Him. You're glad to be acquainted with Him. You're glad to know Him, and you're glad that He knows you and that He loves you and that He cares about you. And then He said, here's the twin brother to that one, is that you love your neighbor as yourself. And who is your neighbor? Whoever God puts in your path is your neighbor. We're to love that person with a godly love. We're to love that person the way we love ourselves. You love yourself? Pretty much. We love ourselves. And so if we get that right, the Bible, or my Sunday school teacher says everything else will line up. But if we don't get it right, what happens if we don't get it right? What happens if we don't have the right attitude toward God? And we don't love Him with all of our heart, soul, and mind. What happens if we don't love our neighbors as ourselves? Two greatest commandments in all of the Bible. Then none of the others are going to line up, and we're going to fail in this thing called Christianity. If we can't get them right, we might as well be playing dominoes. We might as well padlock the doors and go our separate ways. And do whatever we wish to do. Because we've got to get those things right. In 2014, my theme as your pastor and as your shepherd is going to be those two things. It's loving God, having a right attitude and a right relationship with Him. And it's loving one another, having a right attitude and a right relationship with one another. We've been studying the book of John on Sunday nights. And he's been talking again and again and again and again and again about the importance of loving one another. And he said, this is the message, folks. This message of loving one another. This is the message that we've heard from the beginning. And as you look at that phrase from the beginning, what is it talking about? It's talking about the beginning of the ministry of Jesus Christ. His whole message was this to you and I, is that we're to love one another as Christ loved us. And as we love ourselves, what is your attitude toward God? And what is your attitude toward the brethren? Now, I'm going to make some very bold statements. I may not even get to the part of the sermon I wanted to get to today, but this is very, very important to me. I need you looking right here. Teenagers, looking right here. Please don't have a phone out. I'd hate your mom and dad have to buy you nothing. I need your respect. I need you looking right here because, listen, this is going to determine the next 12 months for us. Here's my heart and my passion and my soul to us today. Can I tell you why we have such a hard time getting church right? I'm about to burn up. I'm gonna get my PJs in a minute. I know, I've been eating good. I eat collard greens for 6 days straight. I did, with cornbread and fatback, so don't laugh at me. Listen, here's why we have such a hard time getting it right. Here's why so many times we come into the house of God and there's brothers mad at brothers and there's sisters mad at sisters and there's brothers mad at sisters and there's sisters mad at brothers. You know why? Because we are trying to do church in the flesh. Can I tell you something? Can't do church in the flesh. Can't do it. Can't do it. You can't worship God in the flesh. You say, prove it. I'm glad you asked me. This is what the Word of God says. The Word of God says, God is a spirit. And they that worship Him must worship Him in spirit and in truth. We can't worship Him in the flesh. What we're capable of doing in the flesh will only yield fleshly results. You with me? What we're capable of doing in the flesh will only yield fleshly results. Now, what are the fruits of the flesh? Let me tell you what the flesh is capable of. He says, but if ye be led by the Spirit, ye are not under the law. Now the works of the flesh are manifest, which are these. Before you got saved, you were carnal. You had the old Adamic nature, a worldly nature, an unsaved nature. You didn't possess anything good in you because of that old sinful, ungodly nature. When you got saved, a new nature moved in. God the Holy Spirit moved in to your heart. Now you have two natures. You've got that old man who's rebellious and unrighteous and ungodly. And you've got that new man, God the Spirit, dwelling in you. Now he can't sin. Okay? Same God as God the Father, God the Son, God the Spirit indwells you. You are indwelled by Him when you get saved. He cannot sin. Okay? So, an old Indian chief on the mission field got saved. Missionary led him to the Lord. He got saved. A few months after he got saved, he went back to that missionary and he said, I feel a battle raging in me. It's like two dogs fighting all the time. You've heard the story, surely. And the missionary says, which dog wins the battle? He said, the one I feed the most. The one I feed the most. You, if you're saved, you have that same battle raging in you. You have the flesh versus the spirit. You have wrong versus right. You have Satan versus God. And that battle rages from the moment you wake up in the morning. That battle is raging. Them two dogs is fighting. And I can tell you every single day of your life, you either yield to God or you yield to the devil. When we came into the house of God this morning, our attitude already suggested that we yield to one or the other. Can't worship Him in the flesh. Got to worship Him in the spirit. Now, so here it is. Here's what the flesh is capable of doing. Here's the fruits that are manifest in the flesh. Adultery. Does everybody know what adultery is? Teenagers, y'all know what adultery is? Do you know? Everybody knows what that is. Adultery. Sex outside of marriage. Okay? Fornication. Premarital sex before you get married. I'm not uncleanness, lavishness. That's sexual excess. Listen to these. Idolatry. That's witchcraft. Okay? Hatred. We all know what that is. Hating our brothers and sisters. Variance. That means discord among the brethren. Emulations. That's jealousy. Or it could be I just drew a blank. What is it? When you want something somebody else has got. It's one of covet. It's covetousness. wrath, strife, that's selfishness. Seditions, that's dissensions. Heresies, that's cliques. Envyings, murder, drunkenness, revelings. As such like of the which I tell you before, as I have told you in times past, that they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. Okay, that's the flesh. That's what it's capable of. That's why we can't worship him in the flesh. We've got to worship him in the spirit. Now let's look at the difference between the fruits of the flesh and the fruits of the spirit. But the fruit of the spirit is, and this is what we're shooting for. This is what we want. This is what we're striving for. Here it is. Now we can have church. Now we can get over all this little petty stuff that keeps us from worshiping God, because this is what the fruit of the Spirit is. It's love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such there is no law. And they that are Christ have crucified the flesh with the affections and lust. If we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. Let us not be desirous of vain glory, provoking one another and envying one another. We can't have church, Miss Kathy, in the flesh. We've got to worship him in the spirit. God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. So we've got to come in with the right attitude, or we've got to come in with the right spirit to be able to worship him. Amen. You know why we're at each other's throat? And I'm not just talking about here, but I'm talking about a church period. Is because we're trying to worship him in the flesh, and you can't worship him in the flesh. Does that make sense to you? Amen. So I said all this to say, what is the secret to spiritual power? What's the secret to power in the Spirit of God? Where is it that we get that from? Turn to Acts chapter 17. And I want to read to you verses 1 through 9. Am I out of time? Acts chapter 17, 1 through 9. Now when they had passed through Amphipolis and Apollonia, they came to Thessalonica, where was a synagogue of the Jews. And Paul, as his manner was, went into them, and three Sabbath days reasoned with them out of the Scriptures, opening and alleging that Christ must needs have suffered and risen again from the dead, and that this Jesus whom I preached unto you is Christ. And some of them believed and consorted with Paul and Silas, and of the devout Greeks a great multitude, and of the chief women not a few. But the Jews which believed not, moved with envy, took unto them certain lewd fellows of the baser sort, and gathered a company, and set all the city on an uproar, and assaulted the house of Jason, not Jason Goodson. Don't worry, Jason. And assaulted the house of Jason, and sought to bring them out of the people. And when they found them not, they drew Jason and certain brethren unto the rulers of the city, crying, "These that have turned the world upside down are hither also, whom Jason hath received, and these all do contrary to the decrees of Caesar, saying that there is another king, one Jesus." And they troubled the people and the rulers of the city when they heard these things. And when they had taken security of Jason and the other, they let them go. Underlined in verse 6, if you would, if you mark in your Bibles, "These that have turned the world upside down." These that have turned the world upside down. When was the last time that you've heard of Christianity turning the world upside down? When was the last time you heard of Christianity or the church causing such an uproar, moving with such authoritative power as these men did? The book of Acts continues what Luke started, which is the 30 years after the ascension of Christ. And the beginning of the spread of the gospel, it was the starting of the church, where the church was established. The gospel was taken throughout the world, even into the darkest parts of the Roman Empire. And God was using ordinary people, empowered by the Holy Spirit of God, to turn the world upside down with the message of Jesus Christ. Pentecostal type power, if you would. What was it about these ordinary people with human frailties and human limitations? What was it about these people that enabled them or empowered them to have such tremendous, tremendous force? What was it? Because that's the question. Is that available to us today? So many times when somebody says Pentecostal power, we get nervous. We talk about the Holy Spirit of God. It scares us to death because he's fixing to say something that's freaky. He's fixing to say something that's going to scare me. Listen, it don't need to be scary. The Holy Spirit lives in you. There's nothing wrong with Pentecostal power. Read it in your Bible, Acts chapter 1 and 2 and 3. There's nothing wrong with that. I'm not talking about any kind of denominational value. I'm talking about a spirit-led, spirit-lived Christianity is what I'm talking about. And how that you and I can be a part of a power that is greater than we are. You and I can be a part of something where souls are being saved, where lives are being changed, where people are being healed by God. Where the world and our community is being changed by a force that's greater than you and I. And that's how it's got to be, because we can't do it. We can't do that in the flesh. That has to be a spiritual thing. That's why I'm saying we can't minister, we can't serve, we can't do things that God wants us to do in our own ability, in our own power. Paul says over and over and over again in Corinthians and Galatians and Ephesians and Colossians and Philippians that this effectual power was given to him by the Holy Spirit. And it was given to these ordinary people. Christ said, greater works than these shall you do, because I go unto my Father. How will you and I be able to do that? How will we be able to be effective? How will we be able to evangelize? How will we be able to go out into all the world and preach the gospel? How will we be able to make a difference in people's lives? Over the next 3 weeks, at least 3 weeks, this is what we're going to be talking about. How to live a spirit-led Christian life. Don't you want to know that? Amen. Don't you? If you want to know that, say amen.
Amen.
I do. I do. I don't want to try to serve God in the flesh. I don't want fleshly accomplishments with my Christian walk. I don't want it with the walk of our church. I want you to enjoy a spirit-led life. Can I say something to you this morning? With all of our organizations, with all of our busyness, with all of our fundamentals, with all of our churches, with all of our programs, with all of our ministries, unless we have the power of God motivating us, inspiring us, compelling us, we're not going to get very far. Oh, we'll accomplish some things. We'll do a few good works. But the goodness of God will not be ours. The greatness of God will not be ours to know. If we're not being moved by the power of God, we're not going to do miraculous works, and we're not going to perform the impossible things. If we're not moved in the Spirit of God, we're never going to be able to overlook one another's faults. If we're not moved by the Spirit of God, if we're moved by the flesh, you know what will happen? I'm not going to forgive you. You're not going to forgive me. I'm going to continue to talk about you, and you're going to continue to talk about me, and we're going to continue to come to church in the wrong attitude, and we're going to continue to try to worship God in the wrong attitude, and we're just going through motions. You see, we must be moved by the Spirit of God. What was it about Paul? What was it about Paul that allowed him to possess this supernatural power to spread the gospel throughout the world? I believe it's quite simple. I don't think it's anything real theological or really hard to understand. I believe it was quite simply is that Paul made more of a surrender to God than we have. Paul yielded himself. He yielded his flesh in surrender to God, and it allowed him to be empowered and filled with the Spirit of God. That's why you hear him saying so many times, I die daily. What is he talking about? Dying to the flesh, yielding to the Spirit. How do I do that? Those 6 points are going to talk about how we yield to the Spirit and how we say no to the flesh. General William Booth, one of my favorite characters in life, as far as what he was able to do for the cause of Christ. He was very powerful. He was very greatly used by God. And you may remember the story, and I've shared this with you before, but he was being interviewed by Queen Victoria. And she said, General Booth, how is it that you have such power, such blessings of God on your life? What is it? You're not a very smart guy. You're not very educated. You don't have a great big old church. You're not the most talented person that I've ever met. What is it? And the story says that he bowed humbly in her presence. And he said, Queen, it's just that God has all there is of William Booth. God has more of him than he has of Paul Goff. And if I want God's Spirit dwelling in me richly and empower me to do the things that God and this Bible calls us to do, God's going to have more of me. And that means that we've got to be able to yield to the Spirit of God. So today, how much time I got? Anybody got a clock? As long as I want. Amen. I like your answer. I'm only going to share this one point with you today. We'll cover the other 5 in the next few weeks because I don't want you to miss this point. Is everybody looking this way? Hey, y'all looking this way? I'm going to give you 6 ways to live the Spirit-filled life. I'm going to give you 6 ways that I believe the Bible teaches for you and I to be empowered to go into the world and make a difference for the cause of Christ. Now, we can just be regular, normal, average, everyday, in the flesh, come to church in the flesh type people, or we can be Spirit-led people empowered by Him to make a difference. Now, which do we want to be? We want to be Spirit-led, and we want to make a difference. Don't you want to see folks get saved? Don't you want to see relationships made right? Don't you want to see people getting baptized? Don't you want to see pews filled up? Don't you want to see Sunday school classes filled up? Don't you? Don't you want to see family members getting saved? Don't you want to see people getting healed? Don't you want the power of God? He said, call unto me and I will answer thee and show thee great and mighty things which thou knowest not, my beloved. Don't be scared of great and mighty things. Let's grasp them and be a part of them and watch God move and work in our lives. Well, if you're interested, here's the first point. I believe one of the reasons Paul was empowered by the Holy Spirit of God is this. Number one, he was saturated with scriptures. The Apostle Paul's life was saturated with scriptures. First and foremost, for the Apostle Paul, there was a knowledge of scriptures. I believe that's the most important thing in our lives. In our Christian walk, I believe the Word of God is the most important thing. Would you raise your Bible up? Hold your Bible in your hand. This is our power. This is it. For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. For it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth. To the Jew first and also to the Greek. This is the power of God. This is our spiritual dynamite. This is our empowerment. Our feeling of the Spirit has to come through the Word of God. Now, beloved, I'm going to make a sharp statement. And I believe it to be truth. Don't hold it against me. But I believe in these United States of America, it should be, ignorance of the Word of God is appalling. There are very few church members, let alone lost people, who know the first thing about the Word of God. I knew it was going to get quiet. There are very few. I'm not suggesting that you're one of those who don't know anything about it. You probably know more than I do. But as a corporate, church-wide body, there are very few people to know the first thing about the Bible. And yet it is the power of God unto salvation. It is our source of empowerment. The Word of God. The world is never, ever going to learn the great truths of the Bible until we teach them. And we're never, ever going to be able to teach them to the world and to our community until we know them. And we're never, ever going to be able to know them until we obey them. I believe the number one reason why we're unable to experience revival in America is not because of our lack of organization. I believe we're more organized than we've ever been. We've got all the tools needed to organize. We can text, we can email. We can tweet. We can do a whole bunch of other stuff that I haven't even heard about yet. We've got bulletins. We got screens. I know you hadn't looked at them yet, but all of our announcements are on the screen every week. And some of you will say, I didn't have a clue that we were having a meeting tonight. Maybe they ain't big enough. I don't know. Brother Kent, can we get bigger ones? I don't know. He said, I'll try. But we got organization. Not a lack of organization. There's not a lack of facilities. We've got wonderful facilities. I remember we used to have tent revivals. I've been to them with a sawdust floor and hard metal chairs and hot. You ever been to Billy Kelly's camp up in Greer, South Carolina? It's hot in Greer, South Carolina. 6 o'clock, 7 o'clock, it's 110 degrees. There ain't no wind blowing. The preacher's preaching and sweating and spitting and sputtering and taking clothes off and passing out. And I mean, we got great facilities. We've got great equipment, sound equipment, wonderful equipment all around us. We've got talent. There's not a lack of talents. It's none of those things that causes us to not be able to have revival. It's disobedience to the Word of God. That's what it is. That's what's causing it. It's not enough to know John 3:16. It's not enough to know Isaiah 53:6. It's not enough to know the Lord's Prayer. It's not enough to know the Beatitudes. It's not enough. The only way to know the Bible is to study it and read it and obey it, to live it out, to make it your own. It must be a roaring roaring flame in our bosom. It must be a constant constraint in our souls to have, to read, to study, to know, to make it our own, the Word of the living God. And not only to know it and to live it and obey it, but then to spread it. The way these people turned the world upside down in Acts chapter 17, number 1, they were spreading the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ. You can mark her down today. We will never, ever experience the power of God until we saturate ourselves with the Scriptures. That's first. We got 5 to go. First and foremost, we must saturate ourselves with Scriptures. I'll promise you this too. You won't be able to do the next 5 without it. We'll not ever be able to accomplish and achieve the next 5 things I'm going to share with you over the next few weeks without the Word of the living God. Do you have your Bible? Do you have your Bible? Hold your Bible. Folks, this is the weapon of our warfare. This is the most important tool we have. If we want to experience the power of God in our lives, we've got to be saturated with the Word of God. You can go from day to day, to week, month to month, year to year, and not pick up this book, not study it, not read it, not obey it if you want to, and we will never experience the power of God in our lives. This is what you need to be feeding yourself. You remember I told you who win the battle? Which one of them dogs would win the battle? It's the one you feed the most. I don't know what kind of music you listen to. Oh my God, he's going, here we go. But I can tell you whatever kind of music you listen to, it's either feeding your flesh or it's feeding your spirit. You make up your mind which one it is. Okay? You don't have to like me. I love you anyway. Because I read my Bible today. I ain't mad. I don't know what you watch. I don't know what you let your eyes see. Y'all looking? But I can tell you this, whatever you're looking at is either feeding your flesh or it's feeding your spirit. I don't know what you listen to. I don't know what you watch. I don't know where you go. I don't know who your friends are. I don't know where you hang out. But I can tell you one thing, wherever you're hanging out at, it's either feeding your flesh or it's feeding your spirit. Preacher, how do I feed my spirit? Get somewhere where there's some good food. Get somewhere where there's a good Bible. Get somewhere where there's the right kind of music. Get somewhere where there's the right kind of fellowship. Go to places that inspire you to live a life that's pleasing to God and obey His Word. Get in those places. Surround yourself with those things and those people and begin to feed the Spirit. And He'll be empowered and win the victory. The Word of God. Saturate ourselves with Scripture. That's the first point. Every member of Wedgefield Baptist Church ought to read their Bibles every single day. If you go from Sunday to Sunday without picking up your Bible, you will never be empowered by the Holy Spirit. You will never love God with all of your heart, with all of your soul, with all of your mind. You will never love your neighbor as yourself if you don't get saturated with the Word of God. Amen. Every member of Wedgefield Baptist Church, if it is at all possible, I believe, this is my opinion, ought to be in Sunday school. I got more amens than I got oh me's. And I don't believe there's any excuses. I don't believe there's an excuse good enough to not be in the house of God for Sunday school so you can study the teaching of the Word of God. I believe you ought to be at the pastor's Bible study on Sunday night. I believe that I'm talking about saturating yourself with the Word of God. Saturating. I believe you ought to read it And I believe you ought to study it. And I believe you ought to underline it. And I believe you ought to highlight it. And I believe you ought to memorize it. I believe you ought to hang it on the wall in your house. I believe you need to hang it on the dashboard of your truck. I believe you need to have it in the bathroom, the outhouse, the man cave. I believe the Word of God ought to be everywhere you can get it. Saturate yourself with the Word of God. And we'll be on our way to being empowered by the Holy Spirit.
Sing like never before, oh my soul, worship your holy name. Jesus, I will worship your holy name. Worship your holy name.
Most gracious Heavenly Father, we ask that you help us to reach those who are listening and those we meet, to come from the hedges and highways, compelled to come to Wedgefield Baptist Church, not knowing why they're coming, but when they get here, they will not want to leave, because they feel the Spirit of the Lord is at work here. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.